9 verse 6, and then Matthew 1:21. Then we're going to go back over to Exodus here just shortly. All right? Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." Then over in Matthew 1:21, it says this, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Now, there was somebody, this gave me an idea for the message. Somebody wrote this in that particular verse. "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name I Am Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." And then in Isaiah 9:6, "For unto us is a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called I Am Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Now, there's a lot of folks that say, you know, you read that wrong, and not really, because of all his wonderful names, and by the way, Wonderful is one of his names. The I Am is the most foundational, its deepest root name of God Himself is I Am. I Am is the umbrella under which all of these other names come. Jesus said, "I am," many times in his claim as the Son of God. He declared himself to be the Messiah. And Jesus could add something else today, though he never quoted it directly. He could have really said, "I am Christmas." You know, you can kick me out of the Nativity, he says. You can name the holiday after somebody else, he says. But I am. I am. I am still the I Am. Let's go over to Exodus chapter 3 and find out where we find this. Starting in verse 10. Exodus chapter 3 and verse 10. It says this, "Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." Moses said unto God, "Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" And he said, "Certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain." And Moses said unto God, "Behold, when I am come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" And God said unto Moses, "I am that I am." And he said, "Thus shalt thou say to the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you." And God said moreover unto Moses, "Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob hath sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations." And this is the account where God called Moses to be that deliverer. And when Moses said, "What am I going to say? Who am I?" He says, "You tell them I am sent you." And so now we see where the I am comes from. You see, there's a lot of folks that say, well, that's Jehovah. Jesus, or God the Father, that's Jehovah. And yes, it is. And it's Christ as well. You see, Jesus is a form of the Hebrew word Jehovah, which is Yahweh, mixed with the word for our Savior, which means salvation. So in the New Testament, we see where Jesus used this name several times. He says, "I am the bread of life. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and life. I am the true vine. I am the good shepherd," just to mention a few. And in John chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you," listen, "before Abraham, I am. I am." Have you ever stopped to think of why God did not continue in the phrase in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14? You ever thought about that? I did. And I'm glad you asked. Why did he just, listen, why did he just say, "I am that I am"? Why did he not go ahead and state what he was? Anybody ever wonder about that? Well, I did, so I'm going to tell you. Now, there's no beginning and no ending to God. There's no boundaries, there's no height, nor depth, or limitations, nothing. And had he stated he was this or he was that would have limited him in that area. I am that I am. What is He? He is whatever you need. As a matter of fact, if you need a comforter, He's a comforter. If you need a provider, He's a provider. If you need a Savior, He's a Savior. If you need an anchor, He's the anchor. If you need an understanding listener, He is just that. There is no limit to what that I am is. Whoa! Friends, we cannot explain God. We can't describe Him except to give what has already been given us in the Word of God. We can't increase Him. We can't decrease Him. We cannot expound upon Him. I am that I am explains several things. First, that He's self-existent. That's not your note. This is just introduction, okay? He is of Himself. He always has been and always will be. It's also saying that He's eternal and unchangeable, always the same, yesterday, today, and forever. And I want to tell you something, my friends. In the world in which we live today, something that is unchangeable, foundational, and rock solid is something that is needed every day. In this world that changes every day. When everybody's opinion changes with the direction of the wind, amen? That He's incomprehensible. Friends, we cannot, by searching, find Him out. This name checks all bold and curious inquiries concerning God. We will never find out all there is to know. He's faithful and true to all of His promises. He's unchangeable. God says, I am, and there is none besides me. There's none. He says, all else have their being from me and are totally dependent on me. Look at the world today. Look at everything we have. Everything is dependent on God. It came from Him. It came from the I Am. Now I want you to turn to John chapter 8 for just a moment. John chapter 8. We're going to start at verse 12. Jesus often qualifies the statement I am, and He explains what and who He is, but He doesn't always. So I want you to look at verse 12. Let's look at John chapter 8, verse 12. It says, Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. So He did qualify. He says, I am the light of the world. But if you go down to verses 16 and 18, He says, and yet if I judge, my judgment is true. For I am not alone, but I am the Father that sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that bears witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. He says, I am one with the Father. He and I are one. And then if you look at verse 23, He said to them, ye are from beneath, I am from above. Ye are of this world, I am not of this world. Amen. Now look at verse 24. He says, I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins. For if ye believe not that I am He, ye shall die in your sins. Now, I want you to notice that little word, He. If you have a King James Bible, it should be in any of the Bibles, but King James especially. Have you noticed that the word He is in italics? Anybody ever notice that? Okay. The word He is in italics. What meaning it was not there in the original language. It was added by the translators for clarification. As a matter of fact, if anything, these KJV translators were very honest people. So they placed in italics words not in the original text, but were implied there. Okay? Trying to help you understand. Now, usually such added words are a real help in bridging this language gap, but not necessarily in this case. You see, Jesus did not literally say, I am He. He just said, I am. I am. He drops all the adjectives. Here we go. English people, ready? All the adjectives, pronouns, and objects. There is a subject, but no predicate. And Jesus boldly declares Himself to be, I am. I am. Now look at verse 28. Then Jesus said unto them, when ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then ye shall know that I am He, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. So it happens again. Jesus sees their unbelief in his claims and says, you may not believe today, but one day in the future you're going to believe. As a matter of fact, in the future, you'll see that I was in the beginning. You'll see that I am that I am. You're going to see that. John 18, Jesus in the garden with his disciples. In verses 4 through 8, it's three more times we see the word he italicized. And he's getting down to the bottom line of who he is. And each time in those scriptures in John 18, verses 4 through 8, three times the word he is italicized. In other words, he's standing there saying, I am, I am, I am. That's all he has to say. I am. Now, Jesus allowed for the moment his divine dignity as the I am to be seen, and thus overall, like in awe, they're like overwhelmed. His assailants. Now, there's reasons, I think, for that. First, I think that Judas and those that were with him might know the exceeding sinfulness of their crime. He let himself be known as the I am. Because I believe all those around, he wanted them to see the true sinfulness of their actions. Also, I believe that he might let them know that he had not submitted to be taken, because they couldn't have had any power over him. They could not have overcome him. I said he did not submit. He submitted. They could not have overtaken him. That's what I meant to say. They could never have overtaken him. Because why? Because he is the I am. And thirdly, that he might sufficiently overawe them so that they would let the disciples go. I believe it's sufficient for Christ simply to say, I am. Now, I want to give you some things about Jesus that all of us have experienced many times and overlooked and forgotten about the I am. And this is where your notes kick in. You ready? So I spent the first 10-12 minutes of this message just an introduction, and the other hour is going to be spent in the whole subject of it. Okay? Yeah, y'all gonna catch that in a minute. Number one, friends, I am the goodness of God. Jesus said, "I am. I am the goodness of God." Friends. Do you realize all of our membership remained safe and secure during those nasty storms throughout the night? And through the ice storm today? For us being here is just representative of that. Friends, not because we're special, but because God is good. Friends, we use the term God is good, and of course He's good, but He can't be anything else. As a matter of fact, He is good because He's God. He's not good because of what he does. We often say people are good because of what they do. Right? We judge that. People are either good or bad based on what they do. Well, he's not God because of what he does, but he is good because of who he is. It's not what he does, but because of who he is. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good, not because of the good that He's done, but because of just who He is. Who is He? The I Am. That's who He is. Friends, He's not good because He does good things for us. He does good things for us because He's God. He's good because He's God, but listen, He's not God because He's good. He's just Him. Friends, He has given us that which we do not deserve. He has not given that which we do deserve. Now, if we were truly honest about, you know, we talk about in Christmas time, we should all get a lump of coal or a bundle of switches, right? And we say, oh, I've been good this year. Wait a minute. You know, you ever ask this, you know, kids get up to Santa Claus and they ask and say, you've been good this year, right? Now, kids are really in the moment kind of people. They don't remember anything. They're like goldfish. They forget things like in like 10 seconds after you start, right? Y'all do know that. Their memory goes. They have to relearn things every 10 seconds or whatever. Yeah, were you good? Yes, that'd be good. You know, words, I was good while I was standing in line, but you wouldn't believe what I did to little Johnny back around the corner. Now, if we are truly real about the situation, would we really deserve gifts? I mean, think about it. Well, yeah, I've been more good than bad. That's not the question. Hey, I was more good than bad on my journey home from Louisville yesterday. I only ran 3 people off the road on the way home. I ran 8 off the road on the way there. Because they deserved it. Yeah. Friends, we need to praise God for His goodness. Because His goodness is far beyond our imagination. We can't imagine what life would be like without the goodness of God upon us. I suppose that would be a view of what hell would be like. Can you imagine no goodness of God anywhere in the world? And you've just started to scratch the surface of what hell's like. Psalm 107 over and over and over again says, "Oh, that men would praise the Lord for His goodness and His wonderful works to the children of men." Repeats it over and over and over again. Praise God for His goodness. Well, number 2 is, I am the grace of God. The goodness of God, now the grace of God. You hear the song, "Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all my sin." I'm here to tell you, there is no measure of grace. There is no measure. And just when you think you can measure it, it gets infinitely more. It is limitless. Anybody ever been to a place that says like a bottomless pit? No, bottomless, like, you know, go get a soft drink and you should, it's limitless. Man, you can just keep drinking, 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 drinking. But eventually they're going to run out. But God's grace never does. Friends, it goes beyond all human imagination. We cannot even imagine grace. There's no way to imagine the goodness, the grace that God gives. And He told Paul, "My grace is sufficient for thee," in 2 Corinthians. He says, that's the "I am" working again. Paul, whatever you need, my grace is going to take care of it. I am that I am, and that's my promise to you. And that's what He said to Paul. And that's what He says to every one of us. My grace is sufficient, friends, for you. But to whom much is given, much is required. Luke 12:48 says, "For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more." But grace. God's grace. Friends, it is by this that one is saved. For by grace are you saved through faith. By grace, not of any works. Because if it was of works, I would fail every time. Yeah, remember the song? I always sing it like this. Yeah, America, America, right? You know, I always remember it that way. God shed His grace on thee. I'm like, oh, I love that song, man. Especially the way he said, I don't even know who the singer is. Louis Armstrong, there you go. "I see skies of blue." No, anyway, so I love America, all right? God shed His grace on thee. And I want to tell you, it is by His grace that neither you nor I have dropped into hell before we got saved either. And it is by God's grace this country is still standing today. Well, I am the glory of God. I am the glory of God. First is that I am the goodness. I am the grace. I am the glory of God. The glory of God is seen through the suffering of His saints. Stephen in Acts chapter 7. God's grace is seen through Stephen. Say, how could that be? I want to tell you something, my friends. God gives dying grace just as good as He gives living grace. What about John and Patmos? God's grace. God's glory was shown there. God's glory was shown through Stephen. Friends, how many dying saints have testified of the glory they witnessed in the crossing over to heaven? Even Moses' face was shown full of the glory of God. And I want to tell you something, friends. That was a covered version of glory. Amen? He just got in on the coattail of glory. You know what I'm saying? If he would have been exposed to the full glory of God, dead, gone. God's glory. Friends, the glory of God is seen through the sinlessness of His Son. God's glory is seen through the sinlessness of God's Son. Now, I'm here to tell you, there's a lot of folks out there that will say that Jesus had an affair with Mary Magdalene. I heard some liberal idiot, theological liberal idiot, say that Jesus had homosexual tendencies towards His disciples. And I said, that's blasphemous. That is straight from the pit of hell. And if you even give ear to that, you just don't. But I'm here to tell you, there's people that will do that. But I'm here to tell you, they cannot make my Savior illegitimate. Because He came and He lived a sinless life. John 17, 4 through 8 tells us all about it. He lived a sinless life, never to sin. No spot of sin was not anywhere to be found. Well, you also see it, the glory of God is sinlessness through His majesty. John 17, 4 says this, I have glorified Thee on the earth. I have finished the work which Thou gavest Me to do. And in verse 5 it says, And now, O Father, glorify Thou Me with Thine own self, with the glory which I had with Thee before the world was. Through His majesty, He gave all of that up to come here to die for you and for me. The glory of God. We failed to grasp the awesomeness of the glory of God. But then through His manifestations, verse 6 of John chapter 17 says, I have manifested Thy name unto the men which Thou gavest Me out of the world. Thine they were, and Thou gavest them Me, and they have kept Thy word. And then through His message in verse 8. Verse 8 talks about the words. Here it is. For I have given unto them the words which Thou gavest Me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from Thee, and they have believed that Thou didst send Me. What's going on? The glory of God is all through all of these things. And because they have come through all of things, through the Lord Jesus Christ, God's glory was shown to man through Jesus. But it first started with His sinlessness. Through His might. You see, in John 17, 2, it says, As Thou hast given Him power over all flesh, that He should give eternal life to as many as Thou hast given Him. Friends, God is proud of His Son, just like we are of our children today. And I want to tell you, God allowed His glory to shine through His Son in all of those ways and more. Well, the glory of God is seen through the substitute for sin. Can I tell you something? Only God could die for sin. Only God could die for sin. Only God could pay the ransom price. And only the Creator could die for the creation. And I'm here to tell you, my friends, when Adam sinned, sin was born inside of him and was passed on to all mankind since then. But God died in the form of Jesus, so that you and I could have that sin debt washed away. Number whatever I'm on, 4 I think. Whew, how many points are there, 10? Oh, there's 5. I thought I had 10. Number 4, I am the gift of God. I am the gift of God. John 3:16 for what? There you go. Some of you knew it. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. And whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The gift. That's why we celebrate this thing called Christmas. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The gift of God. Matthew 11:28, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Another gift. Friends, Christ is in the giving business. He has given us life. He gives us life more abundantly. He gives us salvation. He gives us freedom from those heavy burdens that are upon us. He gives and gives and gives and gives. It's a precious gift. And we need not to take it for granted. But far too many times we do, do we not? Far too many times we take Christ's gift for granted. As a matter of fact, sometimes we get a little selfish with it. We keep it all for ourselves and never tell another soul. As if giving away the gift of God is going to somehow diminish ours. It will not. I want to tell you, God says there's room at the cross. He said there is room. There is always room for one more, for one more, for one more. There will never not be enough room. And we need to be about the business of giving the gift of God away. And telling the gospel of Jesus Christ. Friends, what is a gift? Well, first, it's not anything you can earn. Most of what we give as gifts to friends is merely some type of payback. Right? Somebody gives you a gift and now you're ready to, well, I got to get them something now. Friends, God did not owe man anything. And if someone takes us out to lunch, we feel we must return the favor. But a gift does not demand repayment. Sometimes I'll take folks out to lunch, say, well, I owe you one, you don't owe me anything. That was a gift. That was a gift. Think nothing of it. They say, how many lunches do you buy? More than you think. Friends, man had nothing to do with this gift. As a matter of fact, God did not pay back. He paid up front. God didn't pay anything back. He paid it in full from the start. Ephesians 1:4, according as He has chosen us in Him, listen, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. Friends, before we were even a thought in our parents or man, but way back before anybody was even thought to be here on this earth, they had the plan. The plan was in place. The plan was in place. Well, I am the greatness of God. Number five. We'll close with this. You know, Psalm 8 says, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. I think Sandy Patty sings, oh Lord, oh Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Right? I love her voice. Psalm 99:2 and 3 says, the Lord is great in Zion. He is above all the people. Let them praise thy great and terrible name, for it is holy. Psalm 96:4, for the Lord is great. And greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. Jesus says, I am Christmas and everything else that is, has ever been, or ever will be. I am. I am. I am. And so now we're going to boil it all down to how it applies to us. When does a person get saved? Well, first when they admit their sinfulness and recognize who God truly is. In essence, in a nutshell, it's saying, I am not, but I know I am. I am not, but I definitely know I am. What does that mean about salvation? That He is who He says He is. He is the I am. Friends, what does that say about everyday life? What does that say about everything that we go through in this life? He says, I am the I am. Everyone is subservient to I am. Remember, that's the umbrella. He says, I am. Brother Don, I'm having financial problems. I am. Brother Don, I'm having health problems. I am. Brother Don, I'm having this. Brother Don, I'm having that. I am. He is the I am. And all the promises He has given us in His Word to supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory. Not only that, but He says to give you life and life more abundantly. To give you a joy exceeding above anything you could ever know. On and on and on and on. The promises of God. Grab hold of those promises. Cling to those promises. Because He is the I am. And He will never let you down. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank You.